For centuries, rhino have been emblematic of the African continent. Ancient civilizations covered their effigies in pure gold. The nomadic sun people of southern Africa frequently encountered rhino throughout the region as they followed the great antelope migrations from the coast in the far south right across deserts to the north. Fascinated by this shy, eccentric creature, they immortalized them in their rock art, creating an indisputable record of just how abundant and widespread they were. Today, South Africa is home to over 80% of the planet's rhino population. From around only 400 individuals in the mid-1960s, a fairy tale conservation success story saw that number grow to more than 20,000. But no one could have foreseen the carnage that was about to be unleashed. The number of rhino poached annually increased from 13 in 2007 to 83 in 2008, and then rocketed to 1,215 by the end of 2014. Conservation authorities correctly identified the initial spike as organized crime's announcement that they had entered the illegal rhino horn trafficking arena. Estimated to be worth $10 billion a year, illegal wildlife trade is one of the largest illegal activities in the world, ranked alongside drugs, arms, and human trafficking. The international trade of rhino horn had been prohibited in the late 70s by CITES, the Convention on International Trade in Endangered Species of Wild Fauna and Flora. Concerned about the leakage of locally traded horn into the illegal market, authorities moved quickly and placed a moratorium on domestic trade in rhino horn in 2009. An equally important strategy from a summit called in 2010 saw rhino poaching being elevated to a serious crime status in South Africa. This allowed prosecuting authorities to hand down stiffer sentences while including charges such as money laundering and racketeering, customs and excise violations, and being able to enforce asset forfeiture. This was not the first time the rhino's survival had been challenged in South Africa in the recent past. Ian Player's Operation Rhino in the mid-60s brought the species back from the brink of extinction.
Well, from 437 in 1953, which was the first aerial count done, and I did it, so I know it, through our work, we translocated the rhino all over Southern Africa. And they just grew in numbers. And hunting was part of that, I might add. Because the rhino were hunted, actually increased their numbers, paradoxical as that might sound. Because the people who hunted had paid such huge sums of money that the ranchers were able to buy more land and therefore have more rhino. And not only that, more habitat for other species as well.
Dr. Player's strategy proved that a paradigm shift in a failed or outdated conservation strategy can pay dividends. In fact, so successfully that the largest population of rhino on the planet is now found in the Kruger National Park. The park was first protected by the South African Republic in 1898 and stretches over 19,000 square kilometers from the uppermost province of Limpopo and the Zimbabwe border in the north to the southernmost tip of Mpumalanga in the south. It is now part of the Great Limpopo Transfrontier Park, a peace park that links Kruger National Park with the Gonarezu National Park in Zimbabwe and with the Limpopo National Park in Mozambique. But the success had an unintended consequence. It provided the mother lode for rhino poachers with the risk-reward profile heavily stacked in their favor. A counter-insurgency war was needed if the threat was to be successfully overcome. A retired army general was employed to spearhead the challenge.
We have up to 2 armed incursions per day, over 80 a month sometimes. Last year we were involved in about 60 firefights. On top of that, we had 108 other sightings that did not result in a firefight. You need to convert your ranger corps to an anti-poaching force in terms of training, equipment and leadership.
Additional funding was made available to strengthen the ranger complement and the training doctrine adapted to proactive instead of reactive. In other words, preventing the poacher from getting to their target. But the slaughter continued. While the supply side of rhino horn trafficking was slowly being unraveled, the demand side remained shrouded in myth. Rhino horn was removed from TCM Pharmacopoeia in 1994. It was used for reducing fever and purifying blood. Numerous samples were collected from rhino horn dealers in Southeast Asia and tested at the Veterinary Genetics Laboratory in South Africa. Of the 30 samples tested, none were rhino. Bovine, water buffalo, and sika deer featured prominently. The laboratory findings were not surprising. The high cost of rhino horn meant it was unaffordable for even middle-income earners. The way in which the product was handled by the dealers certainly did not suggest a commodity more valuable than gold and platinum combined. Rhino horn has become a status symbol amongst the wealthy and continues to be used not only as the hangover powder of choice, but also for rhino bangles, beads and ornaments for the wealthy, young and the upper crust of society wanting to show off their wealth in various ways. The hunting permitting system in South Africa was manipulated to supply this lucrative market when pseudo-hunts were created. Thai sex workers' credentials were used to apply for hunting permits. Contrary to regulations, a professional hunter would shoot the animal and the horn exported. Regulations require the permitted hunter to shoot the animal. While the trophy may be exported, it may not be sold. Chamlong Leng Tom Tai, the mastermind of the scheme, was arrested and originally sentenced to 40 years imprisonment for permit violations.
There were clear permit conditions that it didn't comply with. I think the summary of the magistrate demonstrated clearly that our amendments, tightening our laws, is working for us.
To close the loophole that allowed pseudo-hunting, the government revised the norms and standards for the marking of rhino horn and for the hunting of rhino trophies in 2012 and amended the National Environmental Management Laws Act in 2014. These measures have tightened the permit system to prevent further manipulation by, for example, pseudo-hunters. A further deterrent to poachers and to assist forensic prosecutions is mandatory collection and submission of DNA samples of all rhino that are immobilized or hunted. The Veterinary Genetics Laboratory is collecting DNA samples of rhinos across the country to create a database using the unique DNA profile of individual rhinos. The goal is for all rhinos to be on the system. Some breeders harvest their rhino's horn both as an anti-poaching strategy and to stockpile in the event the legal trading becomes a reality. South Africa engaged so-called user countries and signed memoranda of understanding to ensure greater international cooperation aimed at ending rhino poaching. All MOUs are accompanied with negotiated implementation plans that put into action the steps agreed to at political level. These include law enforcement, compliance with international conservation agreements and regulations, such as CITES, and joint legislative development. The first MOU was signed with Vietnam in 2012 in the field of biodiversity conservation and management. This was followed by the signing of a MOU with the People's Republic of China on cooperation in the fields of wetland and desert ecosystems and wildlife conservation. The MOU in the field of biodiversity conservation and management between South Africa and Mozambique was signed in April 2014. A significant development in Mozambique prior to the signing of the memorandum was the enactment of the Conservation Areas Act, making wildlife crimes such as rhino poaching a criminal offence. The development of a joint operations cross-border protocol by the management of the Kruger National Park and the Limpopo National Park will provide for joint cross-border operations, making it more difficult for poachers that use the international border between the two countries as a means of escape to avoid punishment. An additional step has been the introduction of the Strategic Integrated Management of Rhino in South Africa since August 2014. This plan rests on four pillars. Management of rhino populations through, for example, the translocation of rhino from the Kruger National Park to safe havens within and outside South Africa. Compulsory interventions, which include proactive steps to deal with poaching. International and national collaboration and cooperation through, for instance, the conclusion of the MOUs, as well as long-term sustainability measures aimed at ensuring the future survival of the species. In the Kruger Park, rhinos are being moved from poaching hotspots to IPZs, intensive protection zones, where rangers and specially developed high-tech systems create a barrier against poaching. These may include the use of unmanned air vehicles. It is through improved international cooperation and South Africa's participation in organizations such as Interpol and the International Consortium on Combating Wildlife Crime that successes such as the return of confiscated ivory and rhino horn from Hong Kong to source their origins through DNA testing have been achieved. Actionable intelligence remains the cornerstone of identifying wildlife trafficking. So too, strong political will and cooperation between countries in apprehending and convicting the wildlife criminals.
We believe that conservation of a rhino is everyone's responsibility. It is for that reason that we have adopted a slogan that says, "Not on our watch." I would like to make this call for everyone to become part of the solution. Engage with us, make contributions, so that together we can win this battle.